Well, after weeks of anticipation and speculation, election 2013 is finally upon us, and Australian voters are being asked to choose between a renewed Labor Party under Prime Minister Kevin Rudd and the hope, reward and opportunity that is being offered by the Coalition and Tony Abbott. Over the next couple of weeks, we're going to be seeing lots of the party leaders and, of course, the candidates getting out there and doing all they can to secure your vote. With me is Nicholas Reese, a public policy fellow at the Melbourne School of Government, and of course no stranger to election campaigns. He is a former Labor strategist and prime ministerial aide. Thank you very much, Nick, for joining me.
Good to be with you in the University of Melbourne studio, Ryan.
Now, we're a couple of days into the campaign as things stand. How important are those opening moments of an election campaign?
Well, look, it'll come as no surprise to you that there's actually a bit of academic debate on how important election campaigns are to the final result. The Australian Electoral Study would indicate that around 50% of voters make up their minds during the election campaign proper. So given elections are usually decided by under 5%, election campaign is actually very important. As for the first couple of days, they are important as well. Even though there's a lot of evidence to suggest that a lot of voters, up to about 20%, make up their minds in the last couple of days of the campaign, and as much as 10% on the day of the election itself, the opening couple of days are important in terms of setting the dynamic for the campaign. It's a time when people are tuning in. They've just been told that there's an election going to be on and what date it's going to be. And so it's a critical time while people are tuned in for the politicians to be able to get the messages out that they want voters to hear and to set the frame and context for the election.
So they're the two peak periods of voter interest, are they? When the election's called and then again just before voting day itself.
That's the general view, yes. And it's interesting, if you look at the election ads on TV and you look at what the campaign strategists are doing, generally you find there's quite a burst of advertising activity at the start. Often it tapers off a bit and then it ramps up again at the end. That would come out of market research, which would be telling the campaign directors that this is the time when people are tuned in to the election campaign and the issues being fought.
Yeah, well both major parties were very quick off the mark with their first TV ads. It was within 24 hours, I think it was, that they both brought out that first ad, first on social media, as they do these days, and then again on the TVs proper. What did we learn from those opening salvos?
Well, we certainly learned the slogan of the two parties. For Labor, it's a new way, and for the Coalition, it's choose real change. At this stage, they're both running positive ads on television, trying to get out their positive plans for the future, portray the leaders, Kevin Rudd and Tony Abbott, in a positive light. You'd expect that to go on for another couple of days. Usually the first week is full of positive ads, and then the tone usually changes pretty sharply and the negative ads start rolling out. 2010 was quite exceptional in that regard. I think there was maybe 2 days of positive ads before the barrage of negative ads came. I think we're up to day 3 now, and it's still positivity at this point in time.
Is it rare though to have an incumbent and a challenger both running on a platform of change, essentially?
Look, that is an interesting observation, Ryan. You're right, it is a little bit unusual. Both candidates or both parties are running as the parties of change in this election. Obviously, Kevin Rudd as a new way. He's trying to signal to voters that you can have a new style of government, you can have a new way, but you don't have to throw out the government with all the risks that come with that. Tony Abbott is countering that if you want real change, you need to change the government. And he's got a line that he's using where he says, look, if you don't want another 3 years like the previous six, then you need to change government. So, yes, they're both running on a message of change. They're both trying to talk about the future.
And Tony Abbott talking about real change and, of course, real solutions is his other buzzword. What do we know about the policy areas that both parties wish to be focusing on and how they try to set the terms of the debate?
Look, campaign strategy dictates that if you can get the election campaign onto your issues, then you will win. So you might win or lose a day, but if when voters go into the ballot box, they're thinking about your issues and they think it's a referendum on the issue that you've defined the election on, then you will succeed, you will win. So what you've seen in the lead up to the campaign, in the sort of fortnight before, was both sides trying to jettison or take off the table issues which were problematic for them. So with Labor, you saw them trying to take asylum seekers off the table with the PNG solution and some other measures since. Similarly, with Tony Abbott, you saw him trying to shut down education as a subject of debate in this campaign, with him coming out and announcing that he's on a unity ticket with Kevin Rudd and Labor on the Gonski funding reform. Now, what that's all about is them getting those issues off the table so then they can focus the debate on the things they want it to be. And the first couple of days of this campaign have shown us what each side wants the election to be about. For Labor, you see them announcing some new funding for after-hours school care. That's typical of Labor. They want to get the campaign onto bread and butter issues for families, helping families with their kids at school. For the Coalition, they've come out and repeated their pledge to abolish the carbon tax on day one. Now, there's been some different views about the current standing of the carbon tax in the public mind, but clearly the Coalition still thinks it's a winner for them, hence why Tony Abbott came out and did that on day one of the campaign.
And equally, the Coalition still sees border protection and the issue of asylum seekers as a positive, because Scott Morrison is still talking about that, even though we've seen Labor try and neutralise it with, as you say, the PNG plan.
Oh, absolutely. The Coalition will do everything it can to keep asylum seekers an issue during this campaign. They will continue to propose new measures to out-tough Labor, and they'll be doing everything they can to create points of difference with Labor on this issue so that they can then have a debate on it, keep it in the media spotlight, keep it in the public mind, so that voters are thinking about that issue when they go into the ballot box.
Yeah, neither party wants their perceived strength to be neutralised. What about the debates? Every time we have an election, of course, traditionally we have leaders' debates, and traditionally we have debates about those debates.
Yes, and this election has been no different in that regard. Except to say that this election was meant to be the one where the debate about the debates was no longer a debate. You might recall that after the 2010 election, when there was the agreement reached with the independents and the Coalition, I should say, for parliamentary reform, one of the things that came out of that was an agreement for the establishment of an election debates committee, similar to what exists in the United States with their presidential races.
So they would regulate and moderate how that's all operating during the campaign period.
That's exactly right, Ryan. But some of the final details of that agreement never got delivered upon. Political party funding was one, and the establishment of a independent debates committee was another. Thankfully, they did get up, though, the establishment of the Parliamentary Budget Office, which was the third leg of that institutional reform, if you like, around Parliament and elections.
Mm. And when we look ahead to the election campaign in terms of geography now, where do you expect to see the different leaders focusing their attention? Where are the battleground states, if you like?
Look, Queensland and New South Wales are going to be critical in this campaign, in my view. You've seen in opinion polls since the return of Kevin Rudd a surge in Labor's vote in that state, and I think the consensus is that there could be up to six seats that Labor could win in that state. New South Wales will be critical as well. There are five seats, I believe, that are on less than 2%, so the election could easily see many seats change hands in New South Wales. So I expect you're going to be seeing Kevin Rudd and Tony Abbott spending a lot of time in New South Wales and Queensland. I don't think we can discount Victoria's importance in the campaign, though, either. Probably three seats in play in Victoria, Corangamite, Deakin and Latrobe. They're seats that Labor held or won at the last election, and Tony Abbott will be hoping to win some of those seats back now that Julia Gillard, as a Victorian, is no longer the leader of the Labor Party.
So that's sort of been described in the past as the Julia Gillard high watermark, the parochial Victorian vote coming home for her, and the expectation or the hope for Labor now would be that they can simply hold on to that level of support in Victoria.
Yes, that's right. I mean, in 2010, Labor enjoyed a record result in Victoria, recording its highest two-party preferred vote of the modern era and securing 22 seats out of 37 that Victoria sends to the House of Representatives. So, from a high watermark, the the coalition will be hoping to win some of those seats back. And the three seats I mentioned, two in the outer eastern suburbs of Melbourne and one in the city of Geelong, will be where they'll be focusing the ground war, the ground campaign in this state.
The ground war indeed. Thank you very much, Nick.
Thank you, Ryan.